So you're in southern France. Wine. Cheese. But above all else, castles. While many tourists rightly visit the incredible double-walled fortress town of Carcasonne, there are the five sons of Carcasonne, magnificent castles perched in impossible locations in the Pyrenees. Let's see how you visit them and why. In the 11th and early 12th centuries, southern France became a hotbed of religious dissent. Influenced by trade routes and a completely different reading of the Bible, the Cathars believed in many things, including the existence of two gods, reincarnation, and more equal gender roles. Obviously, this was a very dangerous threat to Catholicism. After years of attempted peaceful conversion, in 1207, the papal legate excommunicated Raymond, the Count of Toulouse. After an attempted reconciliation fell through in 1208, the legate ended up dead. Having had enough, Pope Innocent III declared the Albigensian Crusade. What followed was a religious and ethnic cleansing from 1209 to 1229, which brought southern France, hereto independent, under the control of the King of France. But like most religious wars, politics took center stage. The Cathars were propped up by Aragon, seeing them as a check on the rising power of France. Despite its famous walls, Carcassonne surrendered in 1209 after the water supply was cut, though it would change hands several times during the war. The Cathars retreated to a series of castles in the Pyrenees. Exactly what happened at each is the source of much debate and conflicting accounts, but they started the war in Cathar hands and ended up in the hands of the French crown. To visit the castles, you'll need a car. Being an uncouth American who doesn't know how to drive stick, I needed to go out to the Carcassonne airport to find an automatic car. I was able to visit the best three of the five castles while getting a glimpse of the fourth all in one day and returning my rental car just in time. Should you break it up over 2 days to include some wine tasting and scenic meals? Sure, but it is possible to do it in one. Driving south from the airport or the town, you'll pass through small towns and a scenic gorge. The first castle on the route is Puillaurens. First mentioned in 958, the castle today reflects a 13th century design. Spared the wars of the initial crusade, the castle provided refuge to the Cathars fleeing the violence. Records speak of a Cathar presence in the 1240s, but at some point between 1250 and 1255, the castle came under royal French control, where it became one of the many border fortresses against the Aragonese. Hiking through the woods for about 10 minutes, you'll reach the main entrance, a narrow exposed staircase leading to the main gate. If an attacker managed to break through the gate, it was actually a trap. The gatehouse had a second bolted door and arrow holes to mow down any invader. Although the rest of the castle is in ruins, you can explore the walls and towers. 35 minutes away is the most picturesque of all the castles, Queribus. Often seen as the literal last bastion of the Cathars, it sits atop a rocky crest 730 meters high. And that crest is located on top of a mountain. Initially built by the Aragonese, it changed hands multiple times as Aragon and France fought for control over the centuries. What happened to the Cathars who took refuge there in 1255 remains a mystery. Some accounts have them slipping across the border to Aragon. Another account has the castle surrendering as its lord was captured elsewhere. The castle today, despite its incredibly remote location, was strengthened in the 16th century to better withstand cannon fire. But how do you even siege a castle like this? The castle has a water cistern capable of holding 60,000 liters of water with multiple lines of defenses. Hiking to the top, one is rewarded with an incredible view of the Pyrenees. And before you ask, the castle is a no-drone zone, but nobody said anything about the next hill over, and I did check the maps. From the top of Queribus, you have a good view of the next castle, Peyrepertuse. A short 20-minute drive away, Peyrepertuse has the toughest climb to reach it. by far the largest of the Cathar castles, its owner surrendered after the fall of Carcassonne, and the castle formally fell under the French crown in 1240. It remained in French hands, even when Queribus was held by the Cathars or Aragonese. Although most of the castle is in ruins, the walls and natural defenses are still standing. It's hard to see where the rock ends and the wall begins. The final ascent to the upper keep is by the Saint-Louis staircase, carved directly into the rock. After Peyrepertuse, I was completely spent and needed to get back to return my rental car in time. But I did pass the fourth castle of the day, Aguilar. Much smaller and less well-preserved than the other castles, we do know that it violently changed hands several times over the course of the war. But I was done for the day and headed back to Carcassonne. The fifth and final son of Carcassonne, Termes, is located further away above its namesake village. So that's how you visit the Cathar castles in a day. The countryside is full of other activities, scenic hiking, and delicious food and wine. While the beaches of southern France get all the attention, Cathar country is a place I have returned and will always want to return to.
I'll be back.
Thanks for watching. If you liked this video or found it helpful, please give it a like and subscribe, and I'll see you on the next one.